Thank you. So hello everyone. I hope you are all doing well so far. My name is Youssef Benzeghadi. I joined Ubisoft 4 years ago. I worked on a few games there, like The Crew, The Division. And for the past 2 years, I have been hard at work on Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands at Ubisoft Paris Studio. I'm the lead game data analyst and analytics project manager on the game there, which basically means that I'm handling everything about analytics on the game, from deciding what we should and do track to analyzing players' data. At Ubisoft, we have a player-centric philosophy, and when it comes to game analytics, we are using players' data and gameplay data in order to create the best possible games, and Ghost Recon Wildlands really is a prime example of this philosophy, as you are going to see throughout this presentation today. I'm going to share various stories, various solutions, examples, ideas we came up with, which I hope will inspire you to use on your own game, hopefully. But first, what is Ghost Recon Wildlands, if you are not familiar with the game? It's a military online open-world shooter game that you can play either solo or up to 4 players in online co-op. You play as a ghost spec ops soldier, and you have to take down a drug cartel that took over the country of Bolivia. The game is the outcome of years of production. We released it in March 2017. We are currently in the middle of our year 2 of content, and we had more than 10 million plus players 1 year post-launch. We are going to go back in time, it's totally safe, throughout the production timeline of the game, and you are going to see exactly how analytics helped to make Ghost Recon Wildlands a better game. So let's start our story. We are early 2015. At this stage, we are pre-alpha. We already have some playable builds of the game. Some systems are working, some systems are not working. It's totally normal. We are trying to track already a few gameplay elements. But at this point, what we were mostly interested in was to gather player feedbacks. And we challenged ourselves to create a tool in order to industrialize player feedbacks. Why? Well, we were going from Ghost Recon Future Soldier, a very linear game experience, to Wildlands, full open world, like many other Ubisoft games and other huge titles in the industry today. And these games are huge, and almost anything can happen in them due to procedural missions and content, systemic activities, emergent gameplay. So it's no longer enough to gather general feedbacks at the end of a playtest. We need a way to be able to track moment-to-moment feedbacks from our players. We saw what was done by other studios in the industry, notably what was done by Bungie and Destiny 1 and what they called contextual feedback, a very interesting talk from GDC 2015. But we wanted to do something much more complete than just tracking players' feedbacks. So imagine that you have a playtest session of your game ongoing, and at any moment, your player can press a funny combination of buttons to send us a feedback. Maybe he's amazed by what's going on in the game, maybe he's confused, maybe he's frustrated. He can let us know, any moment he wants. At the same time, we do record the playtest videos, and the first thing our tool is capable to do is to merge both the videos and the tracking data, including those feedbacks data, thanks to a timestamp. And the playtest goes on, and at the end of the playtest, we are able directly to confront our playtesters with their feedbacks, with the video, telling them, look, at 3 minutes, seems you are confused, can you tell us why? And the players will tell you exactly why he was confused, which end up in a declarative detailed feedback that we take and put in our tool as well. So at the same place, we have tracking data, including those feedbacks, we have the recorded videos of the playtest, and the actual feedbacks from the players. And the end result of this is a very powerful dashboard that looks like this, where we have all feedbacks from all Ghost Recon Wildlands playtests. They are later sorted by user researchers into categories. So if we give this dashboard to a game designer working on combat, he can just filter feedbacks about combat, and he will be able to see what he wants about this. And better yet, since our tool is merging the feedbacks and the videos, if you click on those feedback, either the textual feedbacks or on the map, it will directly trigger the related playtest video in the same dashboard, just below, at the exact moment of the feedback. This is what we call the feedback logger. And it saved us a lot of time, allowing us to spot very small issues we would probably have missed without it. It's the result of a collaboration between several teams, analytics, user research, and of course, the production team of Ghost Recon Wildlands. We used the feedback logger first on Ghost Recon Wildlands, and it is now used on many other Ubisoft projects. Next, let's move forward on the production timeline of the game. We are not ready to release the game yet, but we are ready to put it in the hands of players in real-life conditions, thanks to a pre-launch live phase. We had multiple ones on Ghost Recon Wildlands, Closed Beta, Open Beta. The first one was what we called an online technical test. It was held exclusively on PC, 6 months before launch. We had a build containing 3 regions of the world, which is worth 8 up to 10 hours of playtime. And we had 23K plus players playing the technical test. And during this test, we tracked a lot of players' data, which ended up in a lot of insights, which we prioritized into clear actionable items for the production team to work on. For instance, we saw that the difficulty of the game was unbalanced. When we checked the tracking data about missions, they were all pretty easy to complete, even those supposedly taking place in a hard region available during the technical test. And at the end of the technical test, there is another team at Ubisoft who is sending post-launch surveys called the CMK. And we saw that players who played the technical test told us in that survey that they felt the game was too easy. So showing both the results from tracking and this survey, we decided to take some actions in order to bring more balance into the difficulty of the game. We nerfed the starter weapons you start with as a ghost, so they are less powerful. We applied different difficulty tweaks, like the number of times you can be revived before a game over. And we also renamed our difficulty options because we saw some discrepancies between the difficulty actually played by the players from the tracking and what was reported in the surveys. And today, the difficulty of the game is perceived as just right. Another example, we saw that the drones in Ghost Recon Wildlands, at any moment, the player character can send a drone to scout areas and mark enemies, was really appreciated by players. However, it was not used by all the players who played the technical test. So we decided to work with the user experience team to create better tutorials about the drones and put them much earlier in the experience of the game. And today, we have more than 95%+ of our player base who use the drones at least once, even though it's not mandatory. And we really wanted to push this because we have different skill trees in the game, one of which is about drones, so not using drones would have been a meaningless skill tree about it. And using the drones also allows you new kind of possibilities in terms of playstyle, so that's why we pushed for this. But what we really managed to test during this technical test was our co-op system. It was the first time the game was in the hand of players in real-life conditions, so they were able to play in co-op at home like they wanted. And there, we identified a critical area of improvement. In Ghost Recon Wildlands, we have a lot of main story missions to play. And to be able to play a main story mission, you have first to unlock it by gathering some intels about it. If I unlocked a mission and you unlocked the same mission, that's perfect. We can play together and we will both progress in that mission. If I unlocked a mission but you did not unlock that same mission, we can still play together in co-op, but at the end, you will not keep the progression. That's what we call co-op assist. We did this because we wanted to bring some narrative consistency to each mission, and we wanted players to first unlock the intels about them and then be able to play them and progress within it. And we assumed that anyway, most players playing in co-op would start together and progress at the same pace. We were totally wrong, and all players during this technical test were exposed to some extent to co-op assist, and we even had 10% of the technical test players who played their entire experience in co-op assist, probably without even knowing it. It was a bit worrying for us, and when we checked the surveys data, no one mentioned progression issues or co-op assist. And it's actually normal, because pre-launch live phase like this, they last just a few days, and players are mostly interested in trying your game and don't really care about progression. So we wanted to focus on this, and we held a dedicated co-op playtest. During 1 week, several groups of players playing in co-op. And at some point, some of them told us that they lost their saves and their progression. We checked the saves were still there. So we checked our feedback logger videos and our tracking data, and these guys were in co-op assist. So a real design feature of the game was perceived as a bug. So we decided to roll back in terms of design for the co-op assist, and we released the game like this. Today, even if you did not unlock a mission, if we play it in co-op, we will both keep our progression at the end. It might seem a little bit simple as a change, but changing something this deeply integrated in the co-op design of the game 6 months before launch was a huge risk and a huge task. It mobilized a lot of efforts on the production and a lot of people. But we were right to do so, because when we released the game, we had more than 73% of our player base who played co-op at least once. In other words, if we did not have fixed the co-op assist issue, almost all our players would have potentially faced progression issues. Next, we are still moving forward in the production timeline. The game is now live. We are in March 2017. We start to acquire millions of players. We start to gather billions of data. We analyze a lot of features about the game. Who is completing the game? What about progression from one mission to another? And at some point, someone comes up and asks me, Yosef, what is the profile of our players? And someone else comes up and asks me the same question, but they are not working at all on the same feature and on the same scope. It's the same question, but they expect different answers. So is there a unique profiling of players? My answer is no. There is potentially as many clusters, segments, profiles, you can call them as you want, as there are questions to answer. For instance, we could segment our player based on how they are using weapons, or based on how they are using vehicles in the game, or even based on what they are paying in the game. At the end of the day, it's the same player base, but depending on how you look at them, it gives you different answers, answering different questions. And sometimes, some questions don't even deserve a clustering analysis. It really depends on the topic. On Wildlands, we had a handful of questions we thought deserved such approach, and I'm going to share with you two major examples right now. First, how do our players play the game? It's a playstyle clustering analysis. To do this, we are taking relevant metrics from our tracking, describing how you play Ghost Recon Wildlands. We are taking relevant metrics from our tracking, describing how our players are playing the game. For instance, number of times you are using the drones per hour, number of stealth kills you are doing, the frequency of kills, are you marking enemies when you are targeting your targets, average kill distance, etc. Metrics that really describe how you play the game. And we ended up with six major groups in terms of playstyle. We have, for instance, snipers. These guys, they mostly play with sniper rifles and attack targets from a long range distance. We have then ghosts and infiltrators. Both of them are very stealthy players. The ghosts, they are stealthy, but they do not hesitate to kill their targets. The infiltrators, they are stealthy, but instead of killing, they tend to mark enemies and they try to avoid them to reach their objective. And then we have the beastiles. I have to admit I belong to this group. Usually, they start stealth, they screw up, switch to assault, and rinse, repeat. And then we have some brutal playstyle like assault and executioners. And then we can start to dig in each of them, gathering more insights. For instance, we know that our snipers are very engaged in the game, very engaged into co-op. And using this info, we can start to leverage some action, as you are going to see a little bit later in the presentation. Next question, what do players play in the game? This time, we are not interested in how they are playing the game, but what exactly they are doing in the game. So we are taking metrics like the number of missions you are completing per hour, the time you are spending free roaming, etc. And we ended up with five groups. We have some pretty expected groups, like mission players and rushers. Both of them are very focused onto missions and or side missions. We have elite players who are basically playing all activities in the game. We have looters who are also playing all activities in the game, but on top of this, they are engaging in the looting mechanic of the game, looting resources, collectibles, etc. And then we have the sandbox players who mostly are free roaming in the open world. We understand all of these clusters and we can address them all, except the sandbox players. What the hell are they doing in the game? So we decided first to cross this data with post-launch surveys from that team again, and we ended up with a few more insights. We know that the sandbox players love the game. They also say that they love all activities of the game, even though when we check the tracking, they are not playing them that much. So it's a bit weird. They say they love open world, which makes sense this time. 81%+ of their time is spent free roaming. They are mostly mainstream players. We notice that they are older compared to the other groups. They have a very slow progression, while the other groups are doing 2, maybe 3 missions per hour. These guys are doing 1, even less. So we have a few more info, but we still don't know who are these guys. And at first, since they are older, we assume that these might be parents letting their children play the game, doing nothing, free roaming, and this hypothesis was totally wrong. So how did we manage to understand who are these guys? That's where user research comes in. We decided to take a look at our playtesters database, and among them, we asked sandbox players to come at UB and play the game so we can sit behind and observe them how they are playing the game at home. We held some interviews, and with this process, we ended up with a better understanding of these players. When doing this, they all mentioned something similar, even though these players we playtested with did not know each other. They all mentioned role play. They are not free roaming in the open world, they are role playing in the open world. And based on the results of these interviews and playtests, we managed to further segment the sandbox player group into 2 subgroups. First is what we called adventurers. The adventurers, they play Ghost Recon as designed. They play a ghost and they are playing the missions, but they really take their time. While other groups may finish 1 or 2 missions in an hour, these guys, they take their time. 1 mission can take 5 hours. And on top of this, they are putting extra challenges to the experience, like, I'm going to do this mission and I'm not using the drone, even though it's not something asked by the game. And the other group is what we call military simulation fans. These guys, they are extremely engaged into customization, and they do not care at all about the content we want to provide them, like missions. They just want to create their own stories with their own set of rules. And they are extremely engaged into co-op and team play. We had some players telling us that I have my group, I am the sniper of a group, and only me can use the sniper. This guy is the engineer, and only him can use the drone, etc. So now that we know them better, we can address this group in-game. For the adventurers, we decided to release post-launch what we called the Ghost Mode, which basically asks you to replay the main campaign of the game, but with extra modifiers and extra challenges, like friendly fire in co-op and the permadeath system. If you die, you die. You have to start all over again. And when we are checking among Ghost Mode players who exactly is playing Ghost Mode, well, it's sandbox players who are mostly playing it. And for these guys, since they don't care about the content we want to give them, we cannot really release new content for them, so we decided to do something else and to help them play together and role-play together. We released what we call a matchmaking mood system, which basically asks players before matchmaking in public co-op why they want to do so. The moods you see there are mostly based on the game design clustering you just saw before, and we added a few more exotic options, such as role-play there, which is for these guys, and when we check who is mostly using the role-play mood, these are these guys, and it's even the 3rd most used mood in this list. So now we managed to address these players as well as the other groups you saw before. Why? Because at Ubisoft, we really value all our players and we are committed to deliver the right kind of content and new gameplay experiences for everyone. And speaking of delivering new gameplay experiences, Ghost Recon Wildlands is a kind of game as a service, a live game. We released multiple updates post-launch for the game, bringing new missions, new contents for players to play and enjoy. For instance, we released a very cool boss fight against the Predator himself in the jungle of Bolivia. We brought back Sam Fisher from our very own Splinter Cell franchise in the game. And 8 months post-launch, we released a brand new game within the game. It's called Ghostwire, and it's our 4v4 player versus player mode. And Ghostwire being PvP, it really deserves focused attention in terms of balancing, and game analytics really help in this department. So we considered Ghostwire as if it was its own game, and it even had its own pre-launch live phases like a closed beta, during which we tracked a lot of things, and we saw that this guy, which is called the Grunt, was totally disliked by players. Ghostwire works a bit like Rainbow Six Siege. There is multiple classes. You can pick one. If one is picked, you cannot take it. You need to take another one. And if all classes you unlocked are picked, you have no choice. You have to play this guy. And another problem is that when you start PvP, the onboarding of our PvP, you have no classes unlocked, so you have no choice. You will play this guy at least once with the first match. And it was not really good because it was not very powerful. When we checked the data, the win rate was horrible, and players did not like him at all. So we decided to put more focus and effort on this grunt, as much effort actually as we were putting on the other real classes. And today, the grunt has a new name, a new design, is much more powerful, and much more enjoyable to play. So now that we have fixed our onboarding issue, we can release the game to our millions of Ghost Recon Wildlands players. PvP is available for free to all Ghost Recon Wildlands players. But we missed something along the way. When we released it, a strong community started to be built around PvP, and they all told us, guys, stop what you are doing. Thermal vision is overpowered. Fix the game. Basically, take a weapon, activate thermal vision. If you see something red, you shoot at it. You are pretty much guaranteed a kill and a win. So indeed, community was right to complain. The thermal vision was unbalanced with a 54% win rate, which is more than the balance that is 50. And on some map of the game, where there is a lot of vegetation and foliage, the win rate of thermal vision was even higher than that, above 60, because some players thought they were hidden in bushes, but not at all. Just put thermal vision, you are not hidden. So we decided to fix this again. And now thermal vision is limited. You can no longer use it from weapons. You can only use it from drones to spot enemies, but not directly attack them. And it's only limited to certain classes, because not all classes can use a drone in PvP. Now, what we are mostly proud about in terms of balancing for our PvP game mode is level design update. This is the quarry map, infamously known internally as the worst balanced map of Ghost War. Basically, if you spawn up there, you have 58%+ of chance to win, which is not balanced at all. How did we fix that? Well, we provided the PvP team back at Ubisoft Bucharest with different kind of maps about all the PvP maps, I mean data maps, like density map, maps showing where players tend to die, like this. Level designer can see where players are mostly dying in each map, and these maps are interactive. You can click there, and it will trigger this, which shows you, okay, a lot of players are dying there from where they have been shot from, which allows us to identify over the top line of sight and fix them by putting extra clovers in the map or new 3D asset in the map to bring more balance to this map. We managed to better balance this map. Truth is, it's not yet totally balanced, but at least we try. And sometimes we don't even need to be as precise with maps and stuff. Just small information are enough to bring more balance to a map. This is the Institute map. Again, two teams are competing in this map. But this time, there is two hostages. One of the team have to defend them, and the attacking team must either kill the defending team or extract one out of two of the hostages. First thing we saw was that one of the hostages was a little bit easier to extract. And anyway, most of the round ended with hostage extraction, which means attacking team wins too much. So we know the issue is attack, and we decided to work on this. We completely changed the layout of the map. We moved one of the attacking team's spawn point there, and we brought the two hostages together, closer together, so they are a little bit easier to defend, and we monitored the change. We went from 58% win rate for the attacking team at our title update 12 to 48% win rate for the attacking team at our title update 14, so bringing a better balance, this time slightly in favor of the defending team. So, job done in terms of balancing there. And Ghost War being a post-launch content, we have very tight schedule, so we are not always able to implement tracking for new content coming into Ghost War, do playtests, analyze everything, and act on it. So when we are not that flexible, we decided to have a backup plan, which is focused playtesting. We are identifying among our playtesters who are playing Ghost War, and among them, who are the most engaged Ghost War players, which we then contact and ask them to come at UB to playtest unreleased PvP content before they are released, and we ended up creating a PvP squad of players coming back regularly each month to try out new PvP content before they are released so we can do playtest, interviews about the content, and gather feedbacks where we are not able to use tracking data yet because it's not implemented as the feature is not ready, sadly. For instance, at some point, we wanted to release an observer mode to Ghost War, which allows new players to spectate a PvP match. And we had some usability issue in terms of button mapping to switch from one player to another. And based on the feedbacks of this player, we went to something that looks like this, which is a little bit painful to scroll from one player to another, to something that looks like this, where you can first select a team and then focus on the player you want to observe, which is much better in terms of experience for the players. So that sums up a bit what we did in terms of balancing for our PvP mod. So as you saw, analytics was at the core of Ghost Recon almost at each step of production, either before launch or post-launch. And the story could have stopped there, but it's not the end. We wanted to do more with Ghost Recon Wildlands in terms of game analytics. We wanted to push some boundaries with analytics-driven features. This is the analytics pipeline, very summarized. Your player is playing, sending us some data. We are analyzing this, getting some insights, taking some actions. That's what you saw so far in the presentation. But today, in Ghost Recon Wildlands, we are able to do this. We can take formatted data and insights and bring them back to the Ghost Recon server themselves. Remember this playstyle clustering? If I know that you are a sniper player, I can take this information that you are a sniper, put it on the Ghost Recon server, and next time you play the game will know a bit more about you, that you are a sniper player, and we can start to do some personalized experience, like talking to you about snipers instead of assault rifle, because we know you are a sniper player. What we wanted to focus on with this kind of technology of analytics-driven feature was our matchmaking for our public co-op. We wanted to create what we call the Friends Factory. We wanted to have a smart public matchmaking, and the goal here is to create friends among our players and community playing public matchmaking, in other words, with random people. So at first, we did not know really how to start, so we started manually with game designers. We sat down and we discussed that, okay, if a player is doing this and this and this in the game, and another player is doing this and this, then it's a match they will probably like to play together. And we ended up with a set of fake play styles. These are not the one you saw before. And some assumptions we asked our online team to integrate in the matchmaking to be sure that players would be matched as we expected to create better co-op experience. Now I have a video to show you what happens when this manual work does not work, and hopefully I can get the first video from there because we tested before, there is no sound. Let's do it, please. Thank you. Can we go back to the presentation? Awesome. So these guys were supposed to be matched together because we assumed they had the compatible data and playstyle, but sometimes it works, sometimes it does not work, as you just saw. So we decided to switch our approach. Instead of doing things manually, we are now doing things with real players' data and some machine learning there. We decided to train a machine learning model with our data scientist in order to try to optimize when you are playing in co-op the fact that players would invite themselves each other afterwards to become friends. To do this, we are using a lot of data, like the playstyle you saw before in the presentation, some game usage data, like how you are playing the game, are you using often a microphone or not, where are you in terms of progression in the game, etc. And these data are used by the machine learning algorithm to score each player, and our online team managed to get those scores and act on them real time. So now, when we are launching a matchmaking in Ghost Recon Wildlands, each player are scored, and it works a bit like a dating app. If two players are supposedly matched together in terms of data, they will be matched together. And when we try to observe if this system is working or not, we are not able to do A-B testing by activating the system for some players and not for some others. So we are doing a sort of sequential analysis and A-B test. We are putting the system off, on, off, and on again, and we see what happens. And when we switch on our enhanced matchmaking with machine learning, we see that we increase the invitation rate, which is the proportion of a couple of players would invite themselves to become friends after playing for the first time as random players. And we also increase co-op playtime. It's not huge. It's an increase of 5, maybe 10 minutes in terms of co-op playtime. But sessions after sessions after sessions, it becomes hours of co-op playtime in terms of game. And since we released recently our matchmaking mood system, we are currently working on a third version of this system, which will rely both on the machine learning algorithm plus the mood system. We can score players based on several data to match them, and since that now we know why they are playing public co-op with the matchmaking mood, we can do an even better system by merging both. But now, imagine what we can do with players' data, not to enhance game features, but to give those data back to the players themselves so they can play with it directly in the game. For instance, gamifying open-world exploration with players' data. And I have another video, so I need some help up there. Thank you. Let's take a look.
Hey, my name is Joseph Benzigeli, Big Data Analytics and Analytics Project Manager on Gossip and Binance. For this year's Games World Conference, it's my pleasure to show you a never seen before in-game analytics-driven feature, proof of concept. As you can see, we managed to re-inject in the game real players' position data. The result is a very precise interactive heat map. Any individual player can see in his world map where all of the players went in our massive open world. Let's select this hotspot and check out what's going on there. The goal here is to gamify players' data in order to drive exploration without overwhelming players with a ton of icons on the map. Rather than a mechanic exploration, this helps a more social and organic discovery of our open world. Such technology could also be used before launch by QC teams to check if all regions in the world have been tested. And look at this, a new side mission. Other players discovered it first and generated data that led us here.
So we can cut there. Thank you. You get the idea. We re-injected players' data in the game. For this example, it's position data. This feature is a proof of concept. It's not live in the game. We might release it post-launch, maybe, but no promise. And it is there to show you that we can do more with players' data in-game for real game features. And when you show this to game designers, first, they start to acknowledge that we can do features using players' data, but it also starts to give them some crazy ideas. A crazy idea like this: since we managed to inject in the game real players' position data, we asked ourselves, what if we could predict where players would go in our open world beforehand, so we create a better open world? So again, we worked with our data scientist to create a machine learning model whose goal is to predict where a player would go and how he would spread in the open world. To do this, we are using real players' position data. We are using the Ghost Recon Wildlands map, plus some metadata describing what's going on in the world, like the position of each mission, positions of roads, positions of foliage, etc. And using this, the machine learns. What you see up there are real data from the players tracked. What you see below is the result after a few training from our machine learning model. It's really close to the reality, so we managed to leverage this post-launch on Ghost Recon Wildlands by telling the model, no, there is a mission there, even though there was not. And we tried a few new fake missions, and why we did this, it was to decide where we would put post-launch mission in terms of position in the open world to match level design expectation, for instance, for our Sam Fisher mission. And the next step is really to end up with an in-engine data-driven level design editor for UB. And the ultimate goal is to optimize cost and quality of our open world production. All of this is a huge teamwork. I notably want to thank Benoit Martinez, who is our lead artist and technical art director at UB, at UBS of Paris, who worked on this and on the heat map you previously saw. I also want to thank our awesome data scientists who worked on both machine learning models for this and for the matchmaking. And I have so many more people to thank, so I cannot name them all. So on behalf of UBS of Paris and the entire Ghost Recon Wildlands team, thank you for your time today. And if you have some questions.
You mentioned that some of the team were coming to you about how do you segment the players. And one of the things you mentioned, it depends on the lens you look through. So you were kind of looking at what they did and how they did it. Did you ever overlay those two ways of looking at players? Or was that ever necessary? Or was it enough to just look at the different types?
You mean crossing both clusters, for instance?
Yeah, to see if they matched up.
We did that. We ended up with several clustering, not answering the same question, but we are pretty able to cross them. And we did so, for instance, with our playstyle clustering and game design clustering. We crossed them to see among each group of game design clusters which were the main playstyle there. And for instance, for the sandbox player, which I talked a lot about, one of the main playstyle was assault, because most of them are not playing in design with missions where you can plan beforehand. They cannot predict what will happen, so a lot of them are finding enemies on the road unexpectedly and end up shooting at them, hence a little bit more assault players among them. So we did cross. We did not gain a lot of knowledge doing so, but we are able to do so.
Hey, how you doing? Cool. Thanks for the talk. Really cool how you mix and match all the different sources to get the best insight. Maybe this question is a little too in the weeds, so just say no if it is. I'm curious, doing really involved, interesting, cool matchmaking generally comes with the trade-off that it takes a super long time. And I'm curious if you were able to solve that problem with the way that you're doing it. Like, are you able to do that great friendship machine and not have matchmaking turn into 7 minutes of watching a menu?
Yes, we are able to do so because the machine learning used for the matchmaking is not a hard criteria. We are not forcing it. So we are putting it as a soft criteria, which means after a few seconds, by default, we put it at 60 seconds. If it did not work, it will be raised and it will not be used. But most of the time, it worked. And for our matchmaking mood system, it really worked really fast. Around 30 seconds is enough to match players with the same mood.
Cool, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Thanks, Joseph. Thank you so
much. You're welcome.